Welcome everybody to Lecture 3, Information Retrieval in the Winter Semester 2017-2018. The lecture is about efficient list intersection. And I will first talk about your experiences with exercise sheet 2, which was about ranking and evaluation. And as you might notice from the different background, something is different today. I'm not actually in Freiburg this week, but in Southeast Asia at a conference in Singapore, to be more precise. And what I'm doing right now, I'm recording the beginning of this lecture from my hotel room, and this will be merged together with a recording from last year for the actual contents of the lecture. And the contents of the lecture will be list intersection. We already talked about list intersection in the very first lecture. We used a very simple algorithm there, the zipper algorithm, and we will recapitulate that and also do some time measurements. And then I will talk about two kinds of improvements: non-algorithmic improvements, which means engineering the code to make it faster, and we will see some very interesting things there, and I'll explain a lot about this. And in the second part of the lecture, we will talk about better algorithms than the linear time zipper algorithm, which we saw in the first lecture. And your task for exercise sheet 3 will be to implement list intersection starting from the baseline and then try to make it as fast as possible using a subset of the tricks I will show you in the lecture, or any other trick which you might think of. And of course, again, we do a small competition. We have prepared a benchmark for you, and then you try to be as fast as possible on that benchmark. So now on to the experiences with exercise sheet 2. So there was ranking and evaluation. That was a nice and useful practical exercise. For some of you, it cost quite a bit of time, mostly due to programming practice issues, as usual. Technically, it was not hard, but it was important to get all the details right. Yeah, if you didn't quite understand something or got a detail wrong, you might get a very bad ranking. And that's, I think, a very important lesson, because that's how it is in practice. So many appreciated the hints and also the unit tests provided in the tip file. Many of you found that it was not easy to beat the simple baseline. We will look at the results in a second. So you had to tune some of the parameters of BM25, like the K and the B, and some of you felt that just by looking at a few queries, so without a lot of training data, that is more like a guessing, and you are right. So this was just it was just an exercise, and in real life you would have much more training data, but that would be too much work for one exercise sheet. So at least one of you did was to exhaustively try all combinations of the parameters. So that's called hyperparameter search, which is of course a good idea if you can afford it. And some of you noticed or found that in Python, the doc tests for floating point numbers and also for the dictionaries were painful. Actually, it's not that painful. Just look at the master solution, and there's a very elegant way to do it. There's always usually an elegant way to do things, and just ask on the forum if you're unsure. And many in their feedback expressed happiness about the comments from their tutors. So the tutors give extensive comments if you want that. You can also tell them that you don't want comments, then they will not give you a lot of comments. So let's look at the result. Let's go to the result table on the wiki. Many of you used that and found that useful. So here's the, let me magnify this a bit, here's the line provided by Claudius. That was the simple baseline, so the numbers are okay but not great. 60% for precision at 3, so in average 60% were relevant from the top 3. That's not a great number, but okay. And for mean average precision, even below 50%. But as you can see from the numbers here, it was, some of you managed to improve this. Some of you also got worse by doing trying to improve it, but it was very hard to get much better, which is also an important lesson, because it's really very hard It's easy to get it better for one query, but to get it better for a whole benchmark of queries is hard. So there are some exceedingly good numbers here in the second row, but I don't think they are correct because they are much better than all the other numbers, and that should always raise a red flag. Yeah. So let me just go back to my slide where I've summarized these numbers. So the baseline numbers were these, and the best results from other participants, except for this suspicious second row, were like 3% better only for precision at 3, and also 3% better in the other measures. And that's actually pretty realistic. Yeah. Every percent also in real search engines like Google is hard work. Yeah. So this was actually intended. So let me just summarize again what you found while working on these improvements. Small differences in the implementation can make a big difference in the result. Yeah. So it's not necessarily that robust. And of course, you try some queries, you change something to make it better for that query, it gets worse for another query, and you have to balance that out, right? That's what you have to work with. Improvements that helped was removing not stop words in general. Stop words are words which don't really carry a meaning, but specific stop words, like movie, right? This is a movie data set. You can ignore the word movie or film in the title. Popularity of documents was very important, and boosting keywords in the title. So many of you found that it helped a lot. So to summarize, tuning a ranking algorithm is super important, obviously, for result quality, but also very hard. Many of you experienced that. In particular, it's very hard to understand, if I change this, what's exactly the effect? How will it percentage and so on. Okay, so that was the up-to-date beginning of the lecture, and we will now be transported back in time to the recording from last year.
So let me go back to the slide. So we have intersected inverted list. Then we went to merging in lecture 2 for these BM25 scores. You also get hits when some words are not in the document. You just add up these scores. However, for efficiency reasons, actually many search engines do the intersect. Google also for the longest time did intersect. It's only in the last 5 years or so that they started to give you results where some words do not occur in the query, because merging is just more expensive. For example, Lucene, which is the most widely used open source search engine, many of you, I guess some of you will know it. It has intersect, which is and merge, which is the OR operator, but the default is always intersect. Yeah, when you don't do anything special, just type the keywords separated by spaces, you get intersect. So today we want to look at efficiency, and so we look at list intersection. Yeah, that's what we will do. So efficiency means time, so we will talk about time. I implement something now, you will implement something, so time measurement, it's not so trivial. It's a bit trickier than it may seem, because you run something once, you run it a second time, we will see that in a minute, and you get a different time, right? There's variation because other stuff is running on the machine, or in Java the garbage collector runs, sometimes it's 10 times slower, right, and you wonder what's happening. Or sometimes data is cached, yeah, if you read from a big file, it's in the disk cache or not, and there are different caches when you allocate memory and so on. I'm not getting into the details here, but there are many reasons why running times vary. So performance tests are not trivial for the exercise sheets, and here today, just repeat 5 times and take the average when you report on the wiki. That's of course again a problem, let me just mention it here. When you repeat something 5 times, you get cache effects, right? Now the result is in all the caches, yeah? If it's small, it's even in the very fast cache of your machine, which means you get results that are faster than they actually would be in practice when you only run it once. So repeating also has its issues. Nevertheless, we will just do it here, yeah? Yeah, there's a question from the back row. Hello, back row. Yeah? Yeah. Yeah, exactly. The question, do we have a problem with just-in-time compilation? That's also, can also be an issue. However, just-in-time compilation, Usually it kicks in when you have a loop which runs for a large number of times, like a million number of times, and then it will kick in the first loop already. So you iterate something a million times, and then it iterated it 10,000 times, and then it realized, okay, this code is going to be used more often, now I will compile it just in time. So it's usually not a repetition thing, but a loop, one loop executed a large number of times. Okay, so here, just for your reference, in Java you can get milliseconds, but you can also get microseconds or even nanoseconds. The resolution will be not that fine, but it will be at least microseconds. That will be important because the lists are large, we give to you, but not huge, so probably you need microsecond resolution. In C++, so for this exercise sheet, Java or C++, no Python, I will say in a second why. That's how you can measure it. So this clock thing, which just measures, this is a C thing, but it's very, you shouldn't use it actually, because the command suggests that you are measuring clock cycles, but actually the resolution is so bad, you will see it when you just print the output, that it's millisecond resolution. You don't get any better resolution. So actually you shouldn't use that. C++ 11 has a chrono library, where you can get a high resolution clock with at least microsecond resolution. So it's just for reference. You can just use it, and I would also use it in the code today. So, rest of the lecture, we will look at two kinds of improvements. One, non-algorithmic improvements. Let's just take the basic algorithm now and just try a few things. And I think this will be interesting. This is what we will code together now. And then you will see how small changes in the code can have surprisingly large impact. Yeah, and that's something very important for practice, right? Also in your job later or when you work on projects. You have the same algorithm, you make some changes in the implementation, and you get a difference. So we just work with the basic zipper thing, which just goes through both lists, right? And implement a few variations. So part of what I write now, we will make it available to you in both Java and C++ so that you can choose. Yeah, and you have something to start with. And I will use Java now because there's more to show. And Python makes little sense here, right? Python has this, you can have lists, or arrays in Python are lists, right? And they are lists of untyped objects, which means an object is actually a huge thing. It stores information about the type and everything. And that's such a huge overhead that performance tuning doesn't make so much sense, right? Python is not for performance. If you want performance efficiency in Python, you use something like Cython, or just write stuff in C and link it together, but not pure Python. So for this exercise sheet, Java and or C++, but we provide basic code for you so that you can get started quicker. Okay, so now let me switch. Now we code for about half an hour, and you have to pay attention that I make no mistakes. Yeah, so you are the human compilers now. So let me posting lists. Yeah, inverted list, I call them posting lists here. So I will write two routines, one for reading from a file. So let me. This was the wrong tab, so let me correct this, I'm sorry. Let me open it here. This is just the skeleton which I provided here. So, I have, we will provide inverted lists for you, and they will look like this. Let me actually go to the wiki and show them to you here. These are the posting lists for exercise sheet 3. There are three of them, Bielefeld, Existence, and Them. There's a story behind it. You will read it on the exercise sheet. This is the inverted list for Existence. So these are just the doc IDs in sorted order, and these are the scores. Most of them are 1. They're actually from Wikipedia, so they are a bit longer. Yeah, otherwise performance experiments are no fun. So you see the last ID is a fairly big number. It's 560 million something. The scores are mostly one, but there's also an occasional two, I think, here. Yeah, and at the beginning, I just have the number of postings or items in the list, yeah? Okay, and here for testing, I have two example inverted lists. They are tiny. So this has just three elements, doc ID 10, 20, 30, score 1, 2, 3, doc ID 10, 20, 40, 1, 2, 4. And this first is just the number of elements in the list, yeah? So let's first, to get started, write a routine to read them. So I've already prepared the test, which is here. So when I read example 1 txt, I should get a list of size 3 with these three elements and these three scores. I've also written something for the test here. Let me just comment this out so that I can already compile before I write the intersect. Okay, so let's implement read from file together. So I need a file reader, and you tell me whenever I make a mistake. Right, let's just do a bit Java here. New file reader file name. Okay, that's how you do it in Java. And C++, it's a very similar, so I need a variable here. Then I need a buffered reader to read from that. Buffered reader. Oh my, the keyboard is wobbly. It's a new buffered reader from this file reader. Okay, so now my, I'm sorry, my first line is a gives me the number of elements in the list. So let me just, the first line is an integer. I want to parse it. And then I guess I take the buffered reader and read the line, right? I read the line and parse it as an integer. I have the number of thingies. And now, yeah, let me I need some while loop here, I guess, where I will now read line after line. So I have a line. I have to split each line in two parts, right? Let me call this parts here. So what will I do? While, yeah, I read it. So I read something from the buffered reader. And I think in Java, this is null when it's at the end of the file. So now I want to the parts. I want to split this line. You tell me when I make a, this should be split. Let me split by, I could use a space, but let me just use, that's a regular expression, right? That's just a sequence of one or more white space. Let me do that, okay. Now I have an ID, which is a integer parse int, and that's the first part. This is an array of two strings now, of course, right? Let me just do it like this, and I have a score, right? Which is the second part. So I should do something with this, but let me first complete the loop. Yeah, this is the basic reading loop, right? And now I should somehow do something with these numbers in each iteration. So let me write some, yeah. Let's use an array list. First, yeah, I want to show you something. That's the data structure for dynamic arrays in Java. You can't write this. I also have it on the slide. This is what I would like to write here. I would like to have an array of int IDs and of scores, but you can't write array list of basic data type. In C++, you can with vector. In Java, you have these types which emulate the basic data types, but of course with some overhead, as we will see. And the same for the scores, right? So I just have two thingies here. Okay, so let me also write here a routine for... So at this point I know how large my list will be, so let me reserve space for n postings. Yeah, postings are the thing in the inverted list. So this is a public void. Let me call it reserve. Yeah, this is now allocating. So IDs is, yeah, a new array list of integer And if I give an argument to the constructor, it might make space for n elements, right? And then the same for scores. Yeah, and then maybe I guess I should have a variable which keeps track of the capacity. I reserve something, so I have a capacity. You will see later why I distinguish between capacity and size here, right? So now with reserve, I have a capacity for n elements, but so far I have no elements, right? You will see in a second why I do it like this. It will allow me to play around a bit with my implementation easily. Okay, so this looks good. So now I have, so at this point here, I could, let me call reserve n, right? I reserve space. So now I also need a method for add posting. Yeah, add posting. So let me call it, add. It's actually all very simple. I want to add a posting to a list. So what do I have? And I have an ID and a score, yeah? So how do I add it? Well, it's IDs. I just, no, it's add, I think, in Java, right? I add the ID to the list of IDs, and I add the scores to the list of scores, okay? Oh, and I should keep track of the size here, right? So now I added something. Size is the number of elements, so I'm adding it here, right? So I can just add it to my list here. So here I add a posting ID score. So I think now I have a... Yeah? It misses which attribute? Oh, down here, it's a... Yeah, I have them at the... Yup, okay, so these are the... Yeah, these are the member variables, the IDs, the scores, capacity, and the size. Let's just look how I wrote my test, whether it's... Oh yeah, here I have a size. Okay, for the test, I want to get ID, a certain ID and get a certain score. Let me also implement those functions here at the end. Let me put that at the top. So simple getters, So one is get the ID at position I. So this is just return IDs, get I, right? The same for the score. Yeah, I'm doing this here. I didn't want to throw the code at you because, so if you want to use Java, you will be, you just see that it's doable. So scores get I, right? And then I also need size, right? So int size just returns the size, right? Just some simple getters. Okay, so this looks good. So now we have post for reading the list. And here is the, here it checks whether it read the list. Let's just see whether it compiles. So what is the makefile in C++ or for Python? For Python, we had a trivial makefile. For Java, is a build file, right? It looks like this. That's just, but we give it to you. You don't have to write it. You can just use it as it is. And the make equivalent in Java is arnt, right? So now I can write arnt compile. It will look in the build file. What should I do for compiling? And now it will compile. See a read line. We forgot the parentheses. Okay, no problem. You didn't pay attention. But this is, where is it? Here, right? Read line needs empty brackets. Okay, let's compile again. Okay, another error, 37. Was I too fast? Are you asleep? Oh, what's wrong here? Missing? Oh, a missing return. Okay, so I just have to return something so that it at least compiles. Let's see. Okay, let's see if the test works. I only have the read test so far. It works, yeah? So, reading worked, fine. Let's continue. So now let's write code for, let's read the read to inverted lists. Actually, we have already written half of the code, with the rest will be. So I want to read two posting lists from my file. Let me show them to you on the wiki again. There were three of them here. Bielefeld is very short, so deliberately we have three different ones. A very long one, them, it's a frequent word, it's super long. Existence is half long. Oh, now it takes so long because showing it in and Bielefeld is very short. So list one is a new posting list here. So I have two lists now, and list two. So list one, read from file. Oh, and actually they are here in my, I have them here already, right? Posting list subdirectory, Bielefeld, existence, and them. So let me posting lists, which one do I take first? Maybe existence dot, is it txt? Yeah, okay. That's my first list, and that's my second list. Let me also do some timing, right? So that's a long in Java, time one system. I think it's system, right? Let's use nano time, why not? We can always divide it and get, and let's just, yeah, we will do some more time measurements. So let me spend some time here on, so. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for paying attention. Say it again. Where do I have postings list? I think it's posting list. Oh yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Read lists in time, so what? Yeah, that's true. Yeah, lack of sleep. Never program with lack of sleep. Okay, so we have, let's do it like this. Do we still have, so that's microseconds now, right? And sizes are, yeah, let's just output them for, so size one is list one dot size. Just to see whether everything is correct. List two dot size, and that should be it. Does this look good? Now it should read the list, and yeah, let's just try it. And just does everything, runs the test, builds a jar file. This works. Yeah, this is also what the build file does. So now I have a jar file, I can run it. Read lists in time. Okay, probably sizes are this and this. This looks good. Okay, sizes are fine. Okay, we read the lists. They are now in memory in an array list. And now let's do the intersect. Let's implement the intersect together. Let's first comment out the test, which I have already prepared. When you intersect these two lists, 10, 20, 30 and 10, 20, 40, then there's 10 and 20, which are in both lists, and you have to sum up the scores. 10 has score 1 and 1, which gives 2. 20 has score 2 and 2, which gives 4. So this should be the result, right? 2, 10, 20 with scores 2 and 4. Let's just implement the basic intersect again. So now we, let's just take the, I think this will be useful, the size of the two lists here. I think we need that more often in the code. Yeah, that's the length of the second list. So now what the result list, that's one simple thing we can do already now. What's the maximum size of the result list? It's at most the size of the smaller list, right? So we can, posting list result is new posting list. We don't know how large it will be, but let's reserve space for it. And we know that we don't have to reserve more space than the minimum of these two sizes, right? N1 and N2. This is very wobbly here. Okay, now let's start the list intersection. So we need a, this is the basic zipper algorithm now. So we have one pointer or index in each list. Let me call the index in the first list i1 and the second list i2. I think that's easy to understand. It's a loop. Let's see when we abort it. So now I'm at the beginning of both lists. I'm just implementing again what you already implemented, but I think it's instructive and it's just a few lines. So let me check whether the if i1 is not at the end of the list. I should always do that when I look at the index. And list 1, get, I'm looking at the ID, right? Get ID i1. If this is smaller than the element in list 2, then I want to advance this pointer, right? Okay, now, so now I'm advancing in list 1 as long as the element in list 1 is smaller than the element in list 2 where I'm currently at. So now it might be that I'm at the end of list 1, right? This could happen, and then I'm out. Let me just put these criteria here. Now I can do the same thing for the second list, right? Let me just do it like this. So if I'm in the second list now, and as long as the current element in the second list is smaller than the element in the first list, I increment the pointer in the second list. And now if I'm at the end, what did I do wrong? Yeah, thank you very much. These are nasty bugs, yeah? Okay, so now I did it in this list and in this list. So now it, I might be at a point where they are equal, right? If list 1 get ID i1 is list 2 get ID i2. Yeah, and then I should do something. What should I do? Now I create a new, yeah, I can add a new posting, namely which one? Well, the ID is just, they are the same in both lists, so let me just take it from the first one, right? ID i1, and the score is just the sum of the two scores, right? So it's a get, I already wrote a getter for this, plus list 2 get score i2. And now, so this was the same ID in both lists, so I just advance both pointers, right? And because I don't have a abort criterion here, I mean, yeah, I could write it here or there. Let me write it here at this point. So if i1 or i2 n2, then I'm out. Yeah? That's a problem? I think there's one problem here, namely if this will fail if n1 is 0 or n2 is 0, I can return, right? I can return the result at this point already. And otherwise, I can return it here. Does this look okay? Does it, yeah? That's, can you tell me which line?
54.
Yeah?
I think you don't need it because if I run equals n1,
ah, okay.
Break in line 46.
But n2 could be. i2 could be out of range here, and I'm not testing that here. I want to avoid that additional test. So the comment was, I don't need this. If i2 is at the n2 here, I could get a problem here, right? Because I'm not checking, because I'm always just checking is i1 at the end. So I think I need it. So actually, you're right, I wouldn't need the i1 thing, because that would be taken care of, but the i2 I need here. Okay, so some room for, anyway, we'll work on a few optimizations. Let's see if we are lucky and it works. Wow, so the intersect also works, so I guess it's correct. I think it's correct, yeah? So the test case, it ran the intersect test case as well, yeah? Thanks to you, it worked. So let's do the, we can just copy this here now. Let's do a check at performance tests of the time. Yeah, intersect the two lists. I'm sorry. Intersect the two lists. So I have the two lists. So what do I need here? I need a result list here, one result list, and now result is this was a static routine, so I can just call it like this with the name of the class, intersect list one, list two. Yeah, and I just measure the time, and let me write here. So intersected, and of course I already know time one and time two, so I don't need to declare them again. In time so and so, size is, so this is just the result size now, yeah, just to check whether everything is okay. And we said that we want to do this a number of times, right? So run times. Let me do it 5 times. Yeah, simple loop around this here, and we have it, right? So this is now just intersecting it 5 times. As I said, I will have a few caching effects here. I guess we will see it in the number. And then you are absolutely right. Thank you. So, and here actually we didn't need microseconds because it was... Oh, now it's too long. Let's do milliseconds. So let's see how it looks. And... Yeah, it works pretty well so far because you pay attention so well. Zoop. Yeah. Oh, actually, we can also do milliseconds here. Okay, let's do that. I still use nano time, it doesn't matter. I just put it on the next line here because, yeah, otherwise, yeah, it's always good to pick a unit so that the numbers are in a nice range to read. So, there we go. So, these are not so small lists, yeah, so they are at Yeah, the them list is, no, one of them is the them list, right? It's 2 million in length and 200,000 about in length, right? Takes me 2 seconds to read it, and then the intersection takes about 30 milliseconds. The first one takes a bit longer. That's probably Java getting started with its memory management and stuff, right? But it stabilizes quickly. So let's look at those numbers. Okay, so now we have... a first implementation. Now I want to show you a few modifications, right? This will be fast because we have most of the code already. Let me copy this jar file so that I don't have to copy. Yeah, I don't want to have an if now in my code to try out a few implementations, but I just copy the jar file. I think it's so. This was with array lists, right? This was the basic implementation, which we have now, right? So I can just, yeah, I just copied the jar file. This is our basic implementation. Now let's do one thing, and that's interesting. Let me replace the array lists by native lists, right? I mean, actually, I'm using just array of ints, yeah? And I have a basic data type int. Array list has quite a bit of overhead in Java, which I will show you now. So let me just kick the array list out of my implementation. Let me go to the bottom here. And let me just do the following. Let me just use native arrays here, right? I have them in Java for the IDs and the scores. So I need to do change, yeah, my getter here. It's now not get, but squared brackets, right? Same here. It's now also IDs. It's not a getter, but it's square brackets here. It's also not add now, but it's a bloop. So now it's IDs Yeah, size, I can take size as the index, I guess, right? ID size, and then scores, size is score, so I'm just using native arrays now. Is there anything else? I think in the, here, yeah, I don't allocate array lists now, but a new array of native ints, right? I can do that in, oops, my keyboard is moving. That's increased difficulty level. And I think all the rest just used my getters. That's the reason why I did it like this, and capacity and stuff. So I think all the rest, yeah, here I'm just using these getters and everything. So I don't have to change anything here on the test. Let's see whether it compiles. So all I did now was implementing it with native arrays versus array lists. So, no, this was the old thing. Let's first compile it, but not with ants, but with ant. Oh, it works. So we are really good today. You're paying attention well. So let's first, this was the array list thing. And now the native implementation, suspense. Yeah, it's a difference, right? I would say about a factor. So in reading the file, it's twice faster, because reading the file also has some overhead. But in the intersection, I'm already saving a factor of 3, right? That's very considerable. Maybe let's repeat it to see if there is something. Array lists, native arrays. Yeah? It's 3 times faster. That's with super tiny change. Let me first copy the jar, because I want to do more changes. So this is with native arrays.jar. Let me go to the slides. So array list, much worse than native array, right? I mean, the reason is an array list, I mean, we already did reserve here, so I did that trick for, I told the array list before how large, how many elements I will need, otherwise it would do this dynamic reallocation, it would be even worse, but that would be unfair because I'm doing the same thing for my native array, right? I'm telling it in advance how large it has to be at most, and so I don't need to do dynamic reallocation. Still, array list can't have something like int as a data type, right? You need a class type object like integer, and that just has some overhead, right? It has a constructor, it will do all kinds, it has all kinds of associated code in Java, and that costs you time, right? Actually, if you look at the bytecode, which is a kind of generic machine code, you see that. You see that it does, yeah, it reduces a lot of overhead. And here it's a factor of 3 in this fairly simple intersection algorithm. A factor of 3 is a lot, right? You can be lucky if you improve by a factor of 3 by algorithmic changes. Same question in C++. I will not show it to you here. In C++, the equivalent to array list is the vector from the STL, but that has no loss. That's actually the point of the whole STL, that you don't have any loss when you use this function. It's as good as using native functions if you use it with optimization. And you can write std vector of basic data type int, right? So this is a Java thing. In Java, if you use class types, you have a significant loss, yeah? And this is because of templating. I'm not going into the details here. So that was trick number 1, just use native arrays, right? You should remember that for the rest of your life. If you Java and you actually have arrays of basic data types, use the native arrays, and you're already gaining a lot. Branches. Branches in the code are the conditional parts in your code, yeah? When this gets translated into machine code, the processor has to check, will I continue my code here or there? Why is that important? Branches are very important if you know a bit how modern processors work, right? So in the code, it's the if-then-else part, and the machine code is the jump conditional on the value of some register, right? All modern processors do pipelining, right? Which means you have some instruction which takes maybe 27 clock cycles, right? But now the processor will not execute these 27 clock cycles and do nothing and then execute the next instruction, but actually it will do one clock cycle of this, and then it already wants to start the next one, right? But if you have a conditional, then it doesn't know what the next instruction will be, right? So it has to guess, will it go there? Will the conditional be evaluated to true or to false, right? Yeah, and they do that, yeah? It's built into the processor, guessing the outcome of conditionals. So whatever you can do in your code to minimize conditionals or make them more predictable, which means do them in such a way that they evaluate to the same thing most of the time, right? And actually in this code, there's a very simple place where you can do this. Just something to keep in mind that conditionals cost time. They cost time, produce more complex code, of course, but also due to this stuff. So here, I have one if I'm advancing by one in this list and then by one in this list. I might as well write while here, right? If you think about it, if you have large lists, probably the following will happen, especially if they're of different sizes. You will go quite a bit in this list until you find now this element is larger than here, then you go to the second list, maybe the same thing here, right? So you can do this for a whole stretch, yeah? And for all this time you go there, it will always evaluate to the same thing. Actually, this code should have the same, it should do the same thing. It's just when I can do it several times in a row, do it several times in a row. I think the rest I can just leave it, right? Let's just compile it, whether it works. It does work. And let's run. So this was array lists. This was native arrays with native arrays. 3 times faster, yeah. And now what we have, this is our new one, with a while. Yeah, so this is now 2 to 3 times faster already. And look at this, compared to the ArrayList, we are almost 10 times faster now. 7, 9, 8 times faster maybe, yeah? That's already, with two super simple tricks, we are almost in order of magnitude faster, right? Let me copy this jar file too, right? So algorithms are nice, but implementation tricks very often are even nicer. So let me call it end while, right? Okay. So now I have with, let me show it again. No, this was, let me show it again. With array lists. Yeah, takes a while. With native arrays. And with native arrays and while. Yeah. Ah, now it's, yeah, of course you have variation here. Even something seems to be running on the machine because it's varying more than usual. Yeah, now here we have another factor of 3. Let me show you one more trick, which is sentinels. Conditionals are really a problem, especially if you, right? This is a loop. It's very typical, right? If you process a lot of data, you have a loop which runs a large number of times, maybe millions of times, but it's doing something very simple, right? Anything you can do to improve, simplify this will save you a lot of time. Most of the time goes here in checking these conditions. Am I already at the end of the list? Am I already at the end of the list? I have to do it, right? But most of the time it evaluates to false, but still it's generating code for it. Sentinels, it's a very simple trick. You put something at the end. So in this case, let me just do the following. Let me just reserve space for one more element in the end. Oh my, something happened now. Ah, this is bad. No, okay, some strange key got stored. Now it works. Okay, and in the element, let me just, in the end, add posting with an ID that is integer max value, right? It's just infinity. Let me just put infinity at the end of both lists for the ID. And for the score, whatever, doesn't matter. But this shouldn't count as the size towards the size of the list. So let me subtract size by one again, right? It's just at the end. I will do it for both lists. I just read it in my, did it in my read file method. The test should still work because I'm not counting it towards the size. Yeah, I reserved space for one. That's the reason why I did capacity and size separately. Now, what I can do, let me just see if this works. Let me just remove all these. Yeah. Why does this work? Well, at some point, this element will be no longer smaller than this one because I will reach infinity, right? So let me just do it like this. So the only thing where I have to abort when at the end both lists have reached the end, or if one of them here is, yeah, probably, let me see if that's correct. So if list one get ID I1, if here I'm at infinity, max value, then I'm done, right? At some point I will reach the end of both lists. Then I'm done. Otherwise, I just do as before. Now I don't have any more of these. Am I already at the end of one of the lists? Just by putting infinity at the end of both lists. Let's see if this is correct. Something, a strange key got stored here. I'm sorry. Huh? I added something, but I can't do anything anymore. Yeah. The keys are not doing what they... I think it's caps. I pressed caps lock, control, shift, and F8 at the same time. Oh, whatever. Ah, now it works again. I'm very happy. Okay, let's run it. Okay. Yeah, let me copy this too and let me run it one more time, all of them in comparison. So this is now intersect main native with native arrays and while and sentinels, right? So these are my, yeah, so let me array lists. So this was the first version, array lists. Native arrays and whiles and sentinels. Oh, see, now they're, yeah? So now, of course, you could ask yourself, just the sentinels without, so it seems the while did most of it already, right? And I have some, but it was faster just a second ago, right? Yeah. So the sentinels here, somewhat surprisingly, don't give me a huge improvement. But anyway, all of them together, it's almost a factor of 10, right, from my first implementation. It was all non-algorithmic. Okay, so this was the sentinel thing. Let's go to second part of the lecture, algorithmic improvements, yeah? But very important, yeah? Just by knowing how the compiler works and a few things about the machines, you can get a factor of 10. That's not so untypical, and a factor of 10 is huge, right? That's huge. Hard to get that with algorithmic improvements. So, what can we do to algorithmically improve this list intersection, right? That's the last part of the lecture today. So, sometimes we now make a number of observations. When one list is much smaller and the other is bigger, we can do something, right? So let's always assume now that my first list, it doesn't matter whether I intersect A with B or B with A, right? It's commutative. Let's just take A to be the smaller one, B to be the longer one. Smaller one, K, so K is small, N is large. Think of it like this, yeah? And of course, all the time, both lists are sorted by ID, right? This was already crucial for the zipper algorithm. And we will also use it in the following. So here's, let me just draw some pictures now. So let me switch from coding to drawing pictures here. Yeah. So here is my this is my list A. I will draw a number of these pictures now, and this is my list B. Now I'm always going through the smaller list, right? Pay attention, because one of these you have to implement. And you can pick which one. So at some point here I'm at, let's say here, let me maybe not put an arrow, because it's actually one of the elements. Yeah, this element here is my element A of I. Yeah, it's the ith element of this list. And now this is somewhere in this list. Yeah. And now I have to find it. This list is sorted, so I can just do it with binary search, right? So how do I do this? Let me maybe yeah, let me look here, for example. So here I have B of n over 2, right? And so I wonder, yeah, is is my AI less than B n over, I don't have to write this again, I think. Is my AI smaller than this, then I go here, or is it larger, then I go to the other side, right? So I just do binary search. And the advantage is that I always half the, so let's say it's on this side, right, and then I do let's say I'm going there, and then maybe here I have B n over 4, and so on, and I do the same thing here. Yeah, you get the idea. I'm not doing binary search again now here. So how long does that take? Let's just, I mean, I'm doing this for each element in A. There are k of them, and for each of them I'm doing a binary search, which is log of the length of the longer list, so it's k times log n. Yeah. We are comparing to zipper, which is linear time, n. So this is great when k is very small. Think k 1, then it's log n, right? I just do one binary search, I'm done. So that's a good algorithm when k is very small, right? When k is as large as the longer list, so it's on the order of n, then I'm getting n log n. I'm going from n to n log n. That's worse, right? So it could be better, could be worse, depending on of the length of. So here's a slight improvement. If you think about it only for a little time, then you quickly come up with this. Let me just draw them again here. This is A, this is B, and let's assume I've done it for A of I, and I've located A of I here, right? A of I fits at this place in the list, right? Either there's element in B with that value, or it's just between these two values, right? And now when I do A of I plus 1, yeah, it, let me do it in, yeah, suffices, it's, I know, I mean, I don't have to search here anymore, right? AI plus 1 is bigger than AI, so it's enough to search in this part, binary search, right? Suffices to, let me write it here, to binary search AI plus 1 here, right? In this part. In this part, and let me maybe write the full info, because AI plus 1 is greater or equal to AI, right? It can't be to the left anymore. Okay, so maybe when I iterate this, maybe then I find out that AI plus 1 is located here in list B, it's the longer list, right? And then the same argument goes for this part, and so on. Yeah? So, what's the complexity of this? Well, it depends. I already wrote it up here. What's the best case? The best case is when the first element of A is already at the end of B, right? I do one binary search and now I'm already at the end of B. I don't have to look at the first part again, right? And then for all the remaining elements, I just do very small binary searches. Then I get something like this, super efficient. In the worst case, all the elements of A are at the beginning of the list, right? I mean, there's no guarantee that they are spread out or at the end or the beginning or what, anything can happen, right? And then I have to do basically full binary searches again. So I get what I already got before. Typical case would be they are kind of spread out, yeah? But then it's still k times log n, yeah? Why? Because, let me write that here. I mean, yeah, because log n, if you think about it, let me write it here, because log of n over k, right? If they are spread out evenly, then the gaps would be n over k. That's not different than, I mean, that's basically log n if k is much smaller than n, right? I mean, if you think if k is square root of n, you have n over square root of n, log square root of n is 1/2 log n, right? Same order of magnitude. So you don't really save something. Sure. Yeah. Yeah, just a second. So the the comment was you could make an algorithm which looks at the values of k and n and then decide what it does. This is something you could do. For the exercise sheet, you are very free. You can implement any of the tricks which I showed you here. You should pick three of them. So pick a mixture of non-algorithmic and algorithmic one, and that would be one, right? If k is very small, let me pick this simple algorithm. If it's larger, do something else or more sophisticated. You can do that. You could even make a few probes and see, is my first element at the end? And then, but you have only three lists here, so yeah, the benchmark is very small in this case. So now a more interesting and complicated algorithm. This is the last algorithm, and I want to spend a little bit of time on it. Let me draw another picture to clarify that one. It's actually a very nice algorithm, a nice simple algorithm, and you can implement that. Actually, you should. This is again my A, and this is my long list B. Let me first draw the picture and explain the text while I'm doing this. So I'm drawing a very similar picture now. So here I have A of I, the ith element of, and this here is A of I plus 1. And let's assume I've already done the algorithm to a certain point. Yeah, you will see how. And we have located AI here. Yeah, we have already process the list up to this point. Now, let's say AI plus 1 is here. But we don't know that yet. Actually, we have to find that point, right? So that's exactly, so what we could do now, we should just, this is what the simple algorithm would do, scan until here, until we see, okay, AI plus 1 is here. Yeah, you compare all the elements, blah, 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 until you are here, right? But now, this could be a very long stretch, and it will be if this list is much smaller than this one, right? This is a very long stretch where you're just doing a lot of comparisons just to find out still smaller, smaller, and here. This is where it belongs, right? Let me call this stretch D. And it's actually, so here, it's called D. So that's the gap between two elements. Of course, it can be different for but I just want to explain it here for two elements and one gap. The gap can be different for now AI plus 1 to AI plus 2. And now I want to spend time going from here to there, not linear to D, but log D, That's what I want to do. That's the trick of this algorithm. How can I possibly find this in log d time? And so the trick is as follows. So let me use maybe green here. I do the opposite of binary search, which is exponential search. Let me do it here by example. So I hop by one, and now I'm looking here. Am I already, yeah? I can always ask whether I'm still to the left of AI plus one or to the right. Yeah, I can just look at the element in B here. Okay, I'm still, I find this with a comparison that I'm, now I do a jump of size 2, and I wander here, and now I do a jump of size 4, and now I'm here, yeah? So, at this point, let me write this here, yeah? At this point, after this jump, we know that AI plus one is to the left, right? I can see it by looking at this element. This element will now be, maybe I should write this here, maybe this is some, maybe this is position J1 or J2, just to clarify this here, and J3, right? And I have an element here, and here B of J1 is still smaller than, right? Is smaller than my AI plus one, right? The element in B is smaller. At this point, this is what you would have to write in the code. The element is still smaller. Yeah, and at this point, the element in B is larger, right? So you're doing these exponential jumps and you're always probing B. Is my element B smaller or larger than my AI plus one, right? So here it's, and of course you have to pay attention with less equal or, but let me ignore that here. Yeah, we know that AI plus one is to the left. So, it's to the left, which means, let me make another color, so let me use lots of colors here, yeah. And then do binary search in this interval, right? In this. Ah, it's very hard to write at the bottom, I'm sorry. Can I avoid this somehow? Where could I? No, I can't, I have to. It's very hard for some technical reason. Then do, think about it while I'm writing. I need my full concentration. Binary search. In this interval, yeah, yeah, it's between J2 and yeah, between. Oh, now it gets impossible. Between J2 and J3, right? It's clear, right? When I was at J2, I know I was still to the left, and here I know that I'm to the right, right? Yeah, there's a question. The question is, why don't we do exponential search backwards again? What do you mean backwards again? We do the exponential search to get to the point as soon as possible where we're to the right, right? So what, which jump do you want to do here? By which? By two? Yeah, but you are not gaining something by it, right? If you do the exponential search again, you might still end up here again or something, because you will...
I think we should stop a bit earlier, so we should gain
Yeah, but I think you will not wait a little bit, and I think you will see that you will not gain something by doing another exponential search. But it's a let's see. Let's see whether this question resolves in 2 minutes. So what do we know? We know, note, J3 is minus, oh, and this was J0 here, right? Is at most. Yeah, let me. What can we say about this length? How far did we jump from this position here at most? I mean, we want to find this position, which is d away from this position. So how far did we overshoot at most? I mean, it's at most d, right? Because here, this is just the nature of the exponential search, right? It always doubles, which means the last jump was certainly less than d, right? Which means the actually, what could be the yeah, I think that's correct, right? That is, we overshoot, let me just write it as overshoot by at most d. Yeah? And now we do a binary search in this interval, which is of size at most d, and that takes of log d, right? So the point of the exponential search is to get to this point, not in d time by scanning all the elements here, but in log d time, right? So we overshoot by at most d, but that's no problem, right? That's at most one step more than would be optimal because we are almost doubling, and then we do the binary search. So that's the basic idea. Is there a question about the basic idea? You should ask it now. The rest is just a little more analysis, but that's the slide with the main idea. Let me just, if you would program it, what would you do? Just to clarify this part, you are here, right? Now you would just look ahead one and then two. You just have a variable here which you double each time you look at this position. Do I have to jump further until to the point where the element of B is larger than AI plus one? And then you do binary search in this point and the last point from which you have jumped, right? That would be the code for one step. We have time for a question or two. So, Okay, let's go on to the analysis, which is actually, even if you didn't understand it, no problem. You can follow the next slide. Just believe or remember, depending on whether you understood it or not, to get from one element to the next, I can do it with this algorithm in time log d, not d plus log d. That's the point, whole point of this algorithm, right? I can bridge this gap in time log of the gap, not linear to the gap. So what do we get if we have that? Yeah, let me draw a picture here to clarify this. So what we have again, let me just draw the long list here, B, right? And now what I have, oh, actually I called them J here. So here's the This is the J1. This is where my element A1 belongs, J2, J3, and so on. And this is my JK, right? So my elements in A somehow, yeah, so this is where element A1 fits, this is where element A2 fits, right? Either it's between two elements of B here or exactly like the element of B at that space, place, right? And this is where A of K fits. And now I'm just defining the gaps to be, yeah, I call this gap, let me do it in green. How did I draw the gaps in, oh, in lila. Let me do it in purple. So D1 is, so this should be D1, right? Is that so? D1 is J1 minus, I think that's how I did it. So this is the first gap. This is the second gap. This is the third gap. And this is the last gap, yeah? No, it's not called J, it's called DK, yeah? I don't need that gap because when I found the last element, I'm done, right? I've exhausted my list A. I don't have to look at the rest. So it's good if this is at the front. So, obviously the sum of the gaps is less than the size of the second list, right? Because they are just next to each other. They don't overlap. That's how I defined them. And then, now for each gap, I need time logarithmic in the size of the gap, right? So it's just sum of log of the gaps. Log D1 plus log D2 plus log D3 plus log and so on. So that's not a nice time complexity. Is this good or bad, right? Sum I log DI. Is this good or bad? Is it better than zipper? I don't know. So that's the problem we still have to solve, right? So if you have something like this, the time complexity depends on things which are very dependent on the input, then you just try to upper bound it. So what's the worst case of this? Is the worst case when they are spread out, or is the worst case when they are all next to each other? That's a nice mathematical problem which we will solve on one slide. What I'm claiming, and what is in fact correct, is that this is maximized when they are spread out. So the worst case for this algorithm is actually when they are equally spread out, the elements of A are equally spread out over B. Yeah? And if that is so, then I get, this is K, summation over K things, K times log N over K, right? And I add a plus one here, let me write that here. Yeah, in case k could be n, right? And then I would have n over n, and a log of 1 is 0, right? O of 0 is a bit stupid, yeah? In case, yeah, log n over k would be 0. Not n over k, but n divided by k, right? So that's why I put the plus 1 here. Yeah, it doesn't change the asymptotic complexity. Adding plus 1 just to avoid this 0 case here. Yeah, it's a common thing. So, and this is actually, yeah, let me write it here. Verify yourself. This is never worse this can be very good, right? If you think if k is very small, then I just have log n here, right? So that's a really nice bound. If k is 1, I have log n, one binary search. If k is small, I have something small times log n. If k becomes large, then this part becomes larger, but this part becomes smaller, right? So if k is equal to n, then this part is 1. It's 1 plus 1, 2, log 2 is 1, it's O of n, right? So it's somehow it's going from log n to n, right? A very nice continuum. So Asymptotically, it's the perfect algorithm, actually. And I have one last slide where I quickly show or just state that it's the optimal. You can't do it better, right? So this remains to be done, right? Why is this maximized when they are all spread out? Is there a question about this slide? Is it clear so far? Yeah? Great. So, let me maximize the natural logarithm. Now it doesn't matter, let me just note. Right? Maximizing log di is equivalent to maximizing ln di, right? Because it's just a constant factor, right? Whether I maximize x or 5x makes no difference. Right? And because I'm working with derivatives now, ln is just nicer because I don't have stupid constant factors, right? So, you want to maximize something on the side constraint, that's Lagrangian optimization. We will use it several times in the lecture, so let me quickly show it. It's also a popular exam question, written, both written and oral. It's a very small computation, it just should be in your standard repertoire. Well, maybe you forgot it or never learned it, doesn't matter. I show it to you in a few lines. It's very easy and nice. So what do? You have to write the constraint as an equation. So here that would be the di sum to, not necessarily to n, but some to some n prime, less than n, right? There could be something left in the end. So I can write this as the side constraint as an equation, and I write it like this. This equals to zero. That's what you have to do. And then you define the Lagrangian as follows. It's just the thing which you want to optimize, which is the sum of the logs, plus lambda, some variable which you introduce, times the left-hand side of the side constraint, which should be zero, right? This is just, yeah, there's a theory behind it, that's a mathematical thing, it's actually also easy to prove that if you optimize this, then you solve this constraint optimization problem, right? It's actually, so now all you do is you set the partial derivatives to zero, and that's usually for all our applications in this course super simple. So let's just dl, let's just do the derivative by one of the gaps di. So what do I get? So it's the sum of, so for a fixed I, all of them will be constant except one. And ln x, the derivative, is 1 over x, so it's 1 over di. And actually, let me take minus here, which is as good, because lambda, I just take lambda minus lambda, it's nicer. So, if you take the derivative of this, all terms are constant except one of the di's, so this is just lambda. Yeah, and the di, derivative of di with respect to di is 1, so I get this, and I set these to 0. Which means di is 1 over lambda, which means di are all equal. Now the second derivative, how do you write the second partial derivative? Where do you put the squares? I always forget this. Do you put it here? Hmm? Both of them? I don't think both times. I think that's wrong. One of them should be at the... So what's the second derivative? The second derivative is minus 1 over di square, which is negative, which means we have a max, right? We have a maximum at di equals 1 over lambda, right? So the di are all equal, yeah? So let me just continue from here. Thank you. I always forget it because I didn't understand it properly. If you forget something, forgetting something in math means you didn't understand it. So obviously I should go back and learn this. So the DI are all equal means, I mean the sum of the DI is n prime, which means the DI are n prime over k, right? If they are all equal, which means that my sum, the sum of my k log DIs, because this is a maximum when they are at this value, are less than I 1 over k log of n prime over k. So they are all equal, so it's just k times this, and m prime is less than n, so it's just k times log n over k, right? Which is what I wanted to prove, right? So this is the, yeah, that's how Lagrangian optimization works. We will do it again in the next lecture. Any question about this slide? So you can just learn it as a tool here, right? You just write what you want to optimize, minus lambda times the side constraint, and then you compute partial derivatives, and you put the square at the right place. Very important. Any question? Okay. Yeah, just very quickly, no proof here, I just want to name it. Is this the best possible? This k times log n over k, maybe this fancier algorithm. Actually, you all know or should know the comparison-based lower bound for sorting, right? How does it go? You just look at how many possible permutations there are. If you do comparison-based sort, it's n factorial, right? It's the number of permutations you can have of n distinct numbers. If you do a comparison-based sort, then each step of your sort halves the number of possibilities. So you need at least to be able to distinguish between all the possible outputs log 2 of n factorial. And this happens to be n log n. Yeah, that's why comparison-based sort cannot be better than n log n. Yeah, if you have integers, small integers, you can do it in linear time, but purely with comparison, just this. Same for intersection or union. Yeah. Now you can just look at, let me go back to this picture here. How many ways are there to place the k elements from the shorter list between the elements from B? Yeah, there are only a finite number of ways. And actually that number happens to be n plus k over k, right? This is not so hard to see, but I'm not proving it now. Yeah, and then again, what your algorithm does, the complexity is at least log 2 of this, right? Log 2 of this here can be approximated by this, and this gives this, right? So the same logic gives you what we have just seen as a lower bound. Right? So this is indeed the asymptotically optimal algorithm, but when you implement it, you will find that it's not so easy to make it efficient. Let me just say this here. You are making quite a bit of effort, right, to save time here. That's a very important lesson you will learn in the exercises. You want to avoid doing the scan of this D, but you are making, yeah, you're making jumps and you are maintaining a counter, which is the jump width, yeah, and then you are checking, have I jumped too far, yeah, just to save looking at a few elements here. Of course, it will pay when this D is 1 million, right, then you save a lot. But if this D is 100, you will find it's not so, yeah? You're doing quite a bit of additional work and code just to save a few lookups, right? So there's a trade-off. Complexity of the algorithm and what you save, yeah? So, and here's one final trick which actually lowers that. Let me just, that's super simple. You can also implement that instead. And that's all for today, if we are done with this. So this is just in the longer list, or in fact in any list, because any list could be the longer list. You have a skip pointer at a certain point. So maybe here you have a, let me draw it in purple. You have a pointer here. So maybe here this is element 157, yeah? And then you have a special element here, Yeah, this is a special element, the skip pointer. The skip pointer. Yeah, you just insert into your list some special elements, and it has just written 157. Yeah, which means if you come here from your smaller list with something that's larger than 157, well, just jump over there and continue here, right? That's the point. So if you're coming with an, yeah, so you're coming here with an AI greater than 157, then you just make the jump and go from here, yeah? And you don't have to look at all this, you can skip it, yeah? That's not as flexible as the previous algorithm because these jumps are fixed, but still, it's a simple heuristic and that's easy, yeah? This has much less overhead and can also save a lot, right? And of course the question is, how many of them do I place? Where do I place them? If you want to implement that, you can play around with it. This is actually very simple to implement. Few lines, yeah? Yeah? Say it again. Yeah.
And we remove every element before that. Then this would have the.
What do you mean we would have to remove every element before that? I didn't understand that. So you are coming here with an element AI and you're at this point, so what do you want to do? I mean, that's the situation. You are here, element A is maybe 211, right? And now you're at this point in the list. And now you're, oh, the skip pointer says if you're larger than 157, you can jump and continue here. That's what the skip. Yeah, then you are done. Then you're at the end of the list. If there are no elements that are, then the skip pointer would point to the end of the list, which means you would find out early that you are done already. You just avoid, not sure if that answers your question, but yeah, maybe we take it offline or you ask in the forum. Okay, that's it. As usual, here are some references. Oh my. Let's have a very brief look at the exercise sheet. Yeah. Yeah? No Python. No point in implementing fancy algorithms in Python because it's so slow anyway, right? And so, yeah, this is what you should do. Implement one of the methods and at least three of the ideas. I've presented a lot of ideas today. Pick three of them, right? And try to beat the baseline. Here's the baseline from Patrick. As usual, it will be hard, but not impossible to beat. Yeah, and what you should enter here, average time for the three lists. So there are three lists, three pairwise combination. And here you just write the factor, right? So if you are twice faster, you would write, what would you write here, 2.0? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you just write the factor that you are faster. And you should go list an implementation that is faster for all three of them, just a second. And it will be non-trivial because they have different length ratios, right? Very long with very short with medium length, very long with medium length. There's a question?
Question to the last slide.
Mm-hmm. References or before?
No, before.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're doing this galloping search with that skip pointer,
mm-hmm.
and you jump to the skip pointer, and then you know that you have to jump further. So are you then counting from the skip pointer on the jump, or are you counting the jump from the one?
So the question is, when you're combining this with galloping search, the idea was to use this instead of galloping search. The galloping search has the disadvantage that it's very complicated code-wise. You have to maintain the jump intervals and stuff. No galloping search, just skip pointers. That's not asymptotically optimal, but it's simpler. That's the point. Combining them is also a possibility, but then it would be even more complex, would defeat the purpose in this case. Any other question? You have a question? Or you're just showing me, you're just waving goodbye? No? Okay. Oh, overtime. So have fun with the exercise. See you next week. Bye-bye.